Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bismarck, The Man and the Statesman, by A.j.p. Taylor, narrated by Nigel Patterson. 1. The Boy and the Man. Otto von Bismarck was born at Schönhausen in the old Mark of Brandenburg on the 1st of April 1815. Both place and date hinted at the pattern of his life. Schönhausen lay just east of the Elbe, in appearance a typical Junker estate, some sheep and cattle, wheat and beetroot fields, with woods in the background. Life seemed to follow a traditional rhythm, far removed from the modern world. Yet if Bismarck had been born 2 years earlier, the Kingdom of Westphalia, ruled by Jerome Bonaparte, would have been just across the river. French troops had occupied Schönhausen during the wars. French revolutionary ideas lapped to the edge of its fields. The true Junkers lived far away to the east, in Pomerania and Silesia. These Junkers were a Prussian speciality, gentry proud of their birth, but working their estates themselves, and often needing public employment to supplement their incomes. They looked with jealousy at the high aristocracy with its cosmopolitan culture and its monopoly of the great offices in the state. We may find a parallel in the English country gentry with their Tory prejudices and their endless feud against the Whig magnates. But the Junkers were nearer to the soil, often milking their own cows and selling their wool themselves at the nearest market, sometimes distinguished from the more prosperous peasant farmers only by their historic names. Schönhausen was an estate of this kind, but the winds of the modern world blew around it. Though Bismarck was born a couple of miles on the Junker side of the Elbe, he was always the Junker who looked across it, sometimes with apprehension, sometimes with sympathy. The date of his birth was also significant. A fortnight earlier, Napoleon had arrived in Paris for his last adventure of the 100 days. The old order had a narrow escape. Bismarck, despite his appearance of titanic calm, was always aware of the revolutionary tide that had threatened to engulf the antiquated life of Schönhausen. The Kingdom of Prussia, of which he was a subject, had risen again into the ranks of the great powers, but it had been almost snuffed out by Napoleon. Her statesmen feared that the same fate might come again. It became their dogma: unless we grow greater, we shall become less. This was no basis for a confident conservatism. The very geography of Schönhausen also shaped Bismarck's character and political outlook. It was unmistakably in North Germany, in a district entirely inhabited by Protestants. Bismarck never came to regard the South Germans as true Germans, particularly if they were Roman Catholics. Yet Schönhausen also lay far from the sea. Its inhabitants looked to Berlin as their metropolis, and the connection which Bismarck later established with Hamburg was always rather artificial. If Germany was to expand at all, he preferred that it should be overseas rather than down the Danube, yet both were alien to him. The eastern expansion of Prussia, which had shaped her history, was equally remote for him. Unlike the Junkers of Silesia or West Prussia, he never had a Pole among his peasants. The Poles whom he denounced from personal experience were educated revolutionaries, not workers on the land. It was because of them that Bismarck disliked intellectuals in politics. There was a similar contradiction in his family heritage. His father Ferdinand was a typical Junker, sprung from a family as old as the Hohenzollerns. "A Swabian family no better than mine," Bismarck once remarked. Schönhausen itself symbolised their humiliation, for they had received it as compensation for their original family estate, which a Hohenzollern elector had coveted and seized. The Bismarcks had done nothing to gain distinction during their long feudal obscurity. Ferdinand did not even exert himself to fight for his king. He left the Prussian army at 23 and missed both the disastrous Jena campaign in 1806 and the War of Liberation against Napoleon in 1813. The efficient management of his rambling estates was beyond him, and he drifted helplessly into economic difficulties. It needed a vivid imagination for the sun to turn this easygoing, slow-witted man, with his enormous frame, into a hero, representing all that was best in Prussian tradition. Wilhelmina, the mother, was a different character. Her family, the Menkens, were bureaucrats without a title, not aristocrat landowners. Some of them had been university professors. Her father was a servant of the Prussian state, prized by Frederick the Great and later in virtual control of all home affairs. His reforms and quick critical spirit brought down on him the accusation of Jacobinism. Wilhelmina was a town child, at home only in the drawing rooms of Berlin. She had a sharp, restless intellect which roamed without system from Swedenborg to Mesmer. At one moment she would be discussing the latest works of political liberalism, at the next dabbling in spiritualist experiments. Married to Ferdinand von Bismarck at 16, she developed interest neither for her heavy husband nor in country life. All her hopes were centred on her children. They were to achieve the intellectual life that had been denied to her. Her only ambition, she said, was to have a grown-up son who would penetrate far further into the world of ideas than I, as a woman, have been able to do. She gave her children encouragement without love. She drove them on. She never showed them affection. Otto, the younger son, inherited her brains. He was not grateful for the legacy. He wanted love from her, not ideas, and he was resentful that she did not share his admiration for his father. It is a psychological commonplace for a son to feel affection for his mother and to wish his father out of the way. The results are more interesting and more profound when a son, who takes after his mother, dislikes her character and standards of value. He will seek to turn himself into the father with whom he has little in common, and he may well end up neurotic or a genius. Bismarck was both. He was the clever, sophisticated son of a clever, sophisticated mother, masquerading all his life as his heavy, earthy father. Even his appearance showed it. He was a big man, made bigger by his persistence in eating and drinking too much. He walked stiffly, with the upright carriage of a hereditary officer. Yet he had a small, fine head, the delicate hands of an artist, and when he spoke, his voice, which one would have expected to be deep and powerful, was thin and reedy, almost a falsetto, the voice of an academic, not of a man of action. Nor did he always present the same face to the world. He lives in history clean-shaven, except for a heavy moustache. Actually, he wore a full beard for long periods of his life, and this at a time when beards were symbols on the continent of Europe of the Romantic movement, if not of radicalism. In the use of a razor, as in other things, Bismarck sometimes followed Metternich, sometimes Marx. Despite his Junker mien, he had the sensitivity of a woman, incredibly quick in responding to the moods of another, or even in anticipating them. His conversational charm could bewitch czars, queens, and revolutionary leaders. Yet his great strokes of policy came after long solitary brooding, not after discussion with others. Indeed, he never exchanged ideas in the usual sense of the term. He gave orders, or more rarely, carried them out. He did not cooperate. In a life of conflict, he fought himself most of all. He said once, "Faust complains of having two souls in his breast. I have a whole squabbling crowd. It goes on, as in a republic." When someone asked him if he were really the Iron Chancellor, he replied, "Far from it. I am all nerves, so much so that self-control has always been the greatest task of my life, and still is." He willed himself into a line of policy or action. His friend Kaiserling noted of his conversion to religion, "Doubt was not fought and conquered, it was silenced by heroic will." He felt himself always out of place, solitary and a stranger to his surroundings. "I have the unfortunate nature that everywhere I could be seems desirable to me, and dreary and boring as soon as I am there." He loathed the intellectual circles of Berlin to which his mother introduced him, and in 1848 said to a liberal politician, "I am a Junker and mean to have the advantages of that position." But the years he spent as a Junker, managing his estates, were the most miserable of his life. And when, as Chancellor, he retired to his beloved countryside, he was happy only so long as the state papers continued to pour in on him. He spent the 28 years of supreme power announcing his wish to relinquish it, yet no man has left office with such ill grace or fought so unscrupulously to recover it. He despised writers and literary men, yet only Luther and Goethe rank with him as masters of German prose. He found happiness only in his family, loved his wife, and gave to his children the affection that he had been denied by his mother. He said that in old age his greatest good fortune was that God did not take any of my children from me. Yet he ruined the happiness of his adored elder son for the sake of a private feud, and thought nothing of spending a long holiday away from his wife in the company of a pretty girl. Indeed, he was so self-centred that he boasted to his wife of the girl's charm and good looks. He claimed to serve sometimes the King of Prussia, sometimes Germany, sometimes God. All three were cloaks for his own will, and he turned against them ruthlessly when they did not serve his purpose. He could have said with Oliver Cromwell, whom he much resembled, "He goeth furthest, who knows not whither he is going." The young Junker had no vision that he would unify Germany on the basis of universal suffrage, and the maker of three wars did not expect to end as the great buttress of European peace. Bismarck was not brought up as a Junker, despite his constant assertions of this character in later life. The family moved, soon after he was born, to the smaller estate of Kniephof in Pomerania. Here there was a smaller house with no architectural pretensions and hard practical farming. The Junkers, unlike the English gentry, did not live on rents. They worked the land themselves, and their peasants were, in reality, agricultural labourers, many of whom did not cultivate any land of their own. Bismarck experienced this idyllic existence only till he was 7. Then his mother set up house in Berlin, no doubt much to her own satisfaction, but ostensibly to send her sons to school in the capital. This exile from the country gave Bismarck a lasting grievance against his mother. The education which she chose for him was another. A Junker's son usually went into a cadet corps and later joined a cavalry regiment, even if he was not destined for a permanent military career. Wilhelmina, however, insisted that her children should have an intellectual education suited to the grandsons of the great Mencken, and Bismarck went to the best Berlin grammar school of the day, where he mixed with the sons of middle-class families. His mother revived her connections with the court, and Bismarck led a privileged existence, mixing on intimate terms with the younger Hohenzollerns. This counted in his later career. Despite his sturdy affectation of independence, he was always inside the royal circle and was treated as one of the family. The spirit of the Enlightenment still dominated Prussian education, and Bismarck left school as a pantheist, and if not as a republican, with the belief that a republic was the most reasonable form of state. His mother once more imposed her intellectual standards by sending him out of Prussia to the University of Göttingen in Hanover, the greatest liberal centre of the day. Bismarck at first took a radical line. He defied university discipline both in behaviour and ideas. What was more, he joined the Burschenschaften, students' unions which tried to keep alive the revolutionary spirit of the War of Liberation. He soon turned the other way. It was one thing to pose as a young radical in the court circles of Berlin, quite another to accept these ill-bred students from the middle class as his equals. Personal relations changed Bismarck's political outlook, as was often to happen in his later life. He suddenly discovered pride of blood and joined an aristocratic students' corps. He still led a disorderly existence. He drank a great deal, had some passionate affairs, and like the young Disraeli, wore fantastic and colourful clothes. He was always ready for a duel, though the only time he was injured he characteristically alleged that it was a foul blow, an allegation which he maintained unforgivingly even 30 years later. After 3 terms, debts drove him back to Berlin, where he could live at home, and here he put in a second academic year. In May 1835, when he was just 20, he scraped through the examination which qualified him for entry into the Prussian civil service. Though Bismarck was never a great scholar, his years at the university left their mark. He read widely, despite his boasts of idleness, though he read more history than the law that he was supposed to be studying. He liked Schiller, admired Goethe, and ranked Shakespeare and Byron above either of them, tastes characteristic of the Romantic movement. Scott was his greatest favourite of all, romance and history blended in the right proportions. Bismarck's classical learning was scanty, his scientific knowledge almost non-existent. All the historical references in his speeches are to the 300 years since the Reformation, his occasional echoes of Darwinianism only in what he could pick up from a newspaper. Philosophy never interested him, and he was one of the few Germans to escape the influence of Hegel. People were always more important to Bismarck than books, and he made at the university the only 2 lasting friendships of his life, both with men who were, like him, in a strange environment, fish out of water. Alexander Kaiserling was a German baron from the Baltic and later a distinguished naturalist. John Motley was a budding American diplomat who became the historian of the Dutch Republic. Bismarck trusted himself only to these strangers. The ties of affection between these three never weakened, despite years of separation. Bismarck was writing to dear old John with undiminished enthusiasm 40 years later, and even when he became Imperial Chancellor, would throw aside the cares and dignity of office to make Motley welcome. Kaiserling was less demonstrative, but he too was faithful. After Bismarck's fall from power, Kaiserling, though nearly 80, left his Baltic retreat to console his old friend, and his visit gave Bismarck a last experience of quiet happiness. Bismarck grew up into the Germany of reaction. The great storm of the Napoleonic Empire had been followed by the quiet years. Germany was divided into 39 states, the survivors after much Napoleonic reconstruction. Most of them were tiny, half a dozen were of medium rank, and overshadowing them, the two great states, Austria and Prussia. The Congress of Vienna had tied them all together into a loose confederation, which was supposed to settle internal disputes and even to provide a federal defence force in case of foreign war. In practice, its only function turned out to be the suppression of German liberalism, and it did even that ineffectively. Austria was the presiding power in the confederation. She had the greater historic prestige, an emperor as ruler, and Metternich, the most famous statesman of the day, as chancellor. She had the army of a great power, supposedly capable of challenging that of France, as it had often done unsuccessfully during the Napoleonic Wars. But the Austrian Empire was in decay, its finances shaky, its administration rigid and out of date, its very existence menaced by the rise of Italian and German nationalism. Prussia had been the more severely mauled by Napoleon, and remembrance of this kept her policy safely on the conservative line with Austria. She hardly counted among the great powers. In 1815 there were only 10 million Prussians, as against 30 million Frenchmen and almost 30 million subjects of the Austrian Emperor. Her army was not of much esteem. The other powers relied on conscripts chosen by lot, who served for 15 or 20 years. Prussia made up for her weakness in manpower by giving all or most of her subjects a 3-year training and recalling them for service in time of war. Though this was to be the pattern of all subsequent military development, it was despised by contemporary experts as providing little more than a civilian militia. Frederick William III, who reigned until 1840, was timid and unimaginative, clinging anxiously to Metternich's coattails for protection. During the excitement of the War of Liberation, he promised his people a constitution, but he soon repented of his promise and did not carry it out. All that remained of it was a promise that the Prussian state would not incur any new loan without the consent of some sort of popular assembly. The 8 provinces of Prussia had diets elected on a class basis and with few real functions. For all practical purposes, Prussia continued to be run by a narrow bureaucracy, its standards of efficiency and honesty higher than any other in Europe, but still remote from popular feeling. Germany was still overwhelmingly rural, even Berlin only an overgrown garrison town. The French had begun to develop the coal mines of the Ruhr when they controlled the Kingdom of Westphalia. But the few great capitalists of Germany drew their wealth from commerce and banking on the artery of the Rhine. The customs union, Zollverein, which Prussia had organized by 1834, got rid of most internal tariffs, but trade was on a modest scale, mainly the import of British manufactured goods in exchange for German wool and wheat. There was some intellectual stir in Germany, despite this economic stagnation. The German universities were at this time the best in Europe. The Prince Consort rightly took them as his model when he attempted, somewhat ineffectually, to reform Oxford and Cambridge. Most of the students affected a hazy radicalism. Even Bismarck did not escape this influence. He jeered at the bureaucracy and said to Kaiserling, "A constitution is inevitable. This is the way to honour in the world." Like most of his generation, he thought that Prussia would come to dominate Germany by her liberalism, not by her strength. His short career in the civil service was not a success. In 1836, after a few weeks of training at Potsdam, he was sent to Aachen in the Prussian Rhineland. This territory had been acquired by Prussia only in 1815 as compensation for the Polish lands which Russia insisted on retaining. The inhabitants had no attachment to Prussia. They were Roman Catholics, much influenced by French liberalism and impatient with reaction. They had been included in France for 20 years, and indeed retained the Napoleonic Code until 1900. The Prussian administrators were despised and disliked. But Bismarck did not trouble himself much with the inhabitants. Cosmopolitan travellers passed through Aachen on their way to more fashionable spas, and Bismarck neglected his official duties to mix with this wealthy crowd. He imagined himself in love with one rich English girl after another, allegedly flying as high as a niece to the Duke of Cleveland. Soon he claimed to be engaged to a young lady from Leicestershire. Taking a fortnight's leave, he followed his betrothed across Germany. He ran heavily into debt and overstayed his leave by 3 months. The affair came to nothing, and he was left only with a knowledge of colloquial English. He was too proud to return to Aachen with a request for forgiveness. It is easy to guess what he would have said as chancellor of a subordinate who slipped off in this way. Bismarck merely replied to complaints. He by no means intended to give the government an account of his personal relations. He found a simple means of evading Aachen. Prussians with a secondary education had to serve for a year in the army as officers, and Bismarck still had this hanging over him. He tried to escape by pleading a muscular weakness. "I have told them I feel pain when I raise my right arm." The plea did not work, and Bismarck joined the garrison at Potsdam. He found it tedious, and never having been to boarding school, railed fiercely against the hardships of life in barracks. Yet he led a privileged existence, constantly invited to the royal palace, where he strengthened his acquaintance with the crown prince, soon to be Frederick William IV, and perfected the arts of a courtier. His only achievement in the field was to rescue a corporal who had fallen into a ditch. He received a medal for life-saving, the only military decoration that he ever earned. His later admiration for the military virtues was certainly not based on personal experience or taste, and when his sons did their military service, he lamented their fate with civilian bitterness. In 1839, when his year of service was completed, he resigned from the Prussian bureaucracy. He found high grounds for his action. The Prussian official, he said, was only a member of an orchestra. "But I will play music the way I like, or none at all." His ambition was to have the career of a statesman in a free constitution, such as Peel, O'Connell, Mirabeau, etc. A strange trio. Peel, seeking a compromise between the old England and the new, one can understand. Even Mirabeau, struggling to create a strong constitutional monarchy in the storm of the French Revolution. But how did Bismarck hit on O'Connell, the radical tribune of Irish nationalism? Evidently, principles did not matter to him. The important thing was to take part in energetic political movements. Bismarck was now 24, at a loss for a future. His mother died the same year, with her hopes for her son disappointed. The family fortunes had fallen into disorder through his father's incompetence and neglect. Bismarck and his elder brother established the old man at Schönhausen and took over the Pomeranian estates themselves. Here was the Junker life which had always been Bismarck's ideal, and he anticipated an idyllic existence. "I shall be happy in the country surroundings of my family, car tel est mon plaisir." It soon turned to dust and ashes. He confessed later to his wife, "I learnt only from experience that the Arcadian life of a dyed-in-the-wool landowner with double bookkeeping and chemical experiments was an illusion." The 8 years that he spent as a working landowner were the most wretched and barren of his life. Unlike Cavour in similar circumstances, he never tried to take the lead in agrarian improvements. As he showed later, country life was for him a matter of display, not of genuine economic activity, and he would overspend on his estate at the slightest excuse. In these years, he and his brother restored the family finances by plodding economy, not by any striking initiative. This vegetating life was not enough to satisfy Bismarck's energy. He was driven crazy with boredom and with the futility of his existence. He found the society of his Junker neighbours intolerable, and they in turn distrusted him. His only public achievement was to become keeper of dikes on the Elbe. Symbolic, perhaps, but trivial. He read enormously, history for the most part, and classical English novels. Tristram Shandy especially took his fancy, and he saw himself as the same sort of eccentric. He rode hallooing through the woods at night and seduced the peasants' daughters. He released a fox in the ladies' drawing room. These wild escapades won him the title of the Mad Junker. When money ran to it, he travelled, once to England, where he saw the new industries of Lancashire. He thought of joining the British forces in India, then asked himself, "What harm have the Indians done to me?" and refrained. In 1844 he returned to the Prussian civil service, only to leave it again after a fortnight. His simple explanation was, "I have never been able to put up with superiors." By now he was 30, bitter, cynical and neurotic, his gifts running to nothing. New life came unexpectedly with religion, a wife and a revolution. Bismarck learnt religion from the only neighbours for whom he cared, devout Lutherans who developed a quietist religion in a Quaker spirit. He was impressed by their content and peaceful confidence. Hoping to discover their secret, he spent much time in their company, and he found there a wife, Johanna von Puttkamer. His open avowal of religious belief was no doubt made partly to win her hand. After bearing his soul to his prospective father-in-law, he wrote light-heartedly to his sceptical brother, "I think I am entitled to count myself among the adherents of the Christian religion, though in many doctrines, perhaps in those which they regard as essential, I am far removed from their standpoint, yet a sort of treaty of Passau has been silently established between us. Besides, I like piety in women, and have a horror of feminine cleverness." This letter, too, was a piece of diplomacy, with its repudiation of their mother in the last sentence. Yet there can be no doubt that, whatever reserves he might have for his brother, Bismarck's faith became strong and sincere. His religion was far removed from Christianity, or rather from the humanitarian Christianity of the 20th century. There was in it little love, except for his own family. He believed in the God of the Old Testament and of the English Puritans, the God of battles. Luther or Oliver Cromwell would have understood Bismarck's religion, though it is less easily grasped by those for whom religion is simply a high-flown form of liberalism. Bismarck certainly used war as an instrument of policy and exercised secular power to the full. Anglo-Saxon sentimentalists are therefore inclined to suggest that his religion was a sham. Yet the overwhelming majority of Christians have agreed with Bismarck, both in theory and practice, for nearly 2,000 years. Lutheranism especially never claimed to lay down moral principles for public policy. It taught that service to the state and to the appointed ruler was a high religious duty. Bismarck felt this himself. "I believe that I am obeying God when I serve the king." His religion gave to his unstable personality a settled purpose and a sense of power. He said just after Sedan, "You would not have had such a chancellor if I had not the wonderful basis of religion." He believed that he was doing God's work in making Prussia strong and in unifying Germany. The belief itself brought power. God was on his side. Therefore, he could ignore the opposition of men. Like others who have had this belief, he easily persuaded himself that whatever suited him at the moment was God's purpose, and indeed that he understood this purpose a great deal better than did God himself. Marriage brought to Bismarck lasting and secure happiness. Unlike most men, Bismarck did not marry his mother, but her opposite, a simple, devoted woman, endlessly patient and ready to put up with anything. Under his rough exterior, he was deeply emotional, a man of the Romantic movement. He had grown up just when the Byronic legend dominated the continent. He was the contemporary of Heine and Wagner. Like Gladstone, he was much given to tears at any public or private crisis. No doubt he too would have wept over East Lynne. He broke down sobbing after his first public speech and again after the Battle of Sadowa. He wept when he became Prime Minister, and even more when he left office. William I and he often sobbed together, though Bismarck always got his way. Music affected him deeply, the more because he could neither play nor read it, and by music he meant a soft glow of feeling when the sonatas of Beethoven were played with more expression than accuracy. He agreed with his wife's verdict on Anton Rubinstein, the greatest pianist of the age. "The playing was masterly, both in control and attack, and in everything you like, and yet the heart remains homeless." Johanna gave him a home for his heart, and it was very homely indeed. Though he played high drama on the public stage, his private setting resembled a Victorian boarding house. Even in that tasteless age, contemporaries commented on the banality of Bismarck's surroundings. When Bismarck proposed marriage to Johanna von Putzkammer, he supposed that he was offering her a life in the country. But political activity called him even before the wedding, and the Bismarcks never knew uninterrupted country life until his retirement at the age of 75, and then, much to his regret. Frederick William IV, who succeeded his father as King of Prussia in 1840, was far removed from the usual Hohenzollern stamp. He had an intellect above the average and a fine gift of phrase. Though he asserted his divine right, he strove also for popularity and dreamt of restoring the glories of an imaginary Middle Age, as described in the novels of Sir Walter Scott, when the king was surrounded by his loyal vassals. He thought to ward off a parliament by reviving the estates of the realm, estates which had never existed in Prussia and had long perished elsewhere. This would get round his father's promise of a constitution, and, as a more practical point, allow him to raise a loan for a railway to the eastern provinces of Prussia. In 1847, he summoned the provincial estates to meet as a united diet in Berlin. Bismarck had little prestige among his fellow Junkers, and they had not made him a member of his local diet, only a substitute in case any regular member fell ill. He did not receive the call to Berlin. But in May, a regular member retired, and Bismarck took his place. Only the illness of Herr von Brauchitsch launched him into history. Bismarck said so himself in 1881. "No one would ever have heard of me in my rural retreat if I had not become a member of the United Diet by chance." Bismarck had often expressed his dislike of the absolutist bureaucrat state, and he might have been expected to join with those who were demanding a modern constitution for Prussia. But those who demanded control over the public accounts and regular meetings of the Diet were themselves bureaucrats. Indeed, in a community without political experience, it would have been impossible to provide a quorum for the Diet if state servants had been excluded from it. Thus, when Bismarck attacked the liberals, he was attacking his old enemies. He was a true rebel, though for himself, not for others, always better at destructive criticism than at creation, and never willing to cooperate. Now he found himself, somewhat to his surprise, the champion of historic Prussia, asserting what were in fact the very recent rights of the crown and the nobility. He liked nothing better than to face a hostile assembly, and he got his wish in full measure. Bismarck resisted every liberal proposal. He denounced the emancipation of the Jews and defended the game laws. When a speaker argued that the Prussian people had merited freedom by their services during the War of Liberation in 1813, Bismarck answered, "He had thought that the oppression against which they fought then came from abroad. Now he was taught that it was at home, and he was not grateful for the lesson." It did not need Bismarck to bring the United Diet to deadlock. The majority would not authorize a railway loan without the guarantee of regular meetings, and Frederick William IV would not make this concession to liberalism. At the end of June, the Diet was prorogued. Bismarck had made a name for himself in a narrow reactionary circle. He had high Tory principles, yet a gift of sharp expression that would have become a Jacobin. Perhaps his gift was a little too striking. Slow-witted squires distrust cleverness, even when it is displayed on their side. With the Diet out of the way, he was free to marry and to go on honeymoon. He met Frederick William IV at Venice and received the king's approval for his attitude at the Diet. His future as a reactionary seemed secure. But the old world of monarchy was coming to an end. The continent of Europe had recovered from the exhaustion of the Napoleonic Wars. Everywhere, men wanted to take up the work of the French Revolution and to assert the ideals of individual and national freedom. The year of revolution was approaching. In January 1848, revolution stirred in Italy. On the 24th of February, the French monarchy was overthrown and a republic established in Paris. The revolution soon spread to Germany. A group of learned men called for a German national parliament. On the 13th of March, Metternich, symbol of the old order, was overthrown in Vienna. Prussia was more stable than Austria, its army strong enough to put down any disorder. But Frederick William was not the man for a stern conflict with the revolution. Street fighting in Berlin soon made him lose his nerve. On the 18th of March, he ordered the army to withdraw, announced that Prussia merges into Germany, and agreed to call a Prussian parliament. Bismarck's liberal enemies of 1847 had won. He himself was in the country when the revolution broke out. His first thought was to rescue the king with the aid of his faithful peasants. It was sentimental Jacobitism to suppose that untrained peasants could succeed where the army had failed. Bismarck hurried off to Potsdam and even entered Berlin, wearing a national cockade. He tried to persuade the commanding generals to stage a counter-revolution, but, as on many later occasions, the Prussian generals would not meddle in politics without an order from above. Each would act only if the other generals acted first. They were moved, but not to action, when Bismarck picked out the notes of a cavalry charge on the piano. Finally, he managed to see the king for a few minutes. The queen lamented that the king had been unable to sleep for 3 nights from worry. Bismarck answered, "A king must be able to sleep." In desperation, he planned a reactionary stroke. Frederick William was childless. His brother William, Prince of Prussia, had gone into exile in England. Bismarck sought out Augusta, William's wife, and proposed that Frederick William should be pushed aside. William should renounce his rights, and their young son should be put on the throne as the figurehead of reaction. A similar manoeuvre made Francis Joseph Emperor of Austria in December. In March, it was too early, and Augusta, in any case, too loyal both to her husband and to her brother-in-law. She rejected the idea indignantly and harboured a lasting resentment against Bismarck, which was to hamper him throughout his career. There seemed nothing to be done. Liberalism was in the ascendant. A German National Assembly and a Prussian Parliament were elected, both by universal suffrage, and the electors did not choose Bismarck for either. As a gesture of defiance against the revolution, he began to sign himself von Bismarck for the first time. This was his only concrete achievement during the revolutionary year. Throughout the summer, he drifted round Berlin, attempting to organise the Prussian conservatives and engaging in futile court intrigue. In the autumn, Frederick William plucked up courage. He ordered the army to reoccupy Berlin and dissolved the radical parliament. But he did not intend to restore absolutism. He issued a constitution which provided for a parliament with more restricted powers. The electorate was also limited, and the elections were made indirect. The primary electors did not choose their representative, but only an electoral committee. This gave Bismarck his chance. He was elected to the new parliament by 152 votes of the committee against 144. He was still hostile to Frederick William's attempts at compromise. Later on, he claimed to have acted as a secret adviser in forming the conservative ministry. The king's real opinion of him was expressed in the comment, "Red reactionary, smells of blood, only to be used when the bayonet rules." Frederick William kept up an appearance of liberalism in the hope of leading the movement for German unity. He was always a German nationalist, though he learnt his nationalism from the Romantic movement and not from the French Revolution. Here, too, Bismarck was hostile. He was, he said, a decided opponent of the German swindle in every form, and believed only in the specifically Prussian. He denounced the attempt to force on Prussia the role which Sardinia had played in Italy. Instead, he wanted a conflict between authority by the grace of God and revolution and popular sovereignty. Frederick William hoped to reconcile the two. While the revolution was at its height, the National Assembly at Frankfurt had tried to create a united German state, which would include also the German provinces of Austria. At the end of 1848, reaction triumphed in Vienna, and Felix Schwarzenberg, the Austrian Prime Minister, would have nothing to do with German nationalism. The Frankfurt Assembly had to accept a lesser Germany without Austria, whether they would or not, and in April 1849, they offered the imperial throne to Frederick William IV. The Prussians jumped at this chance of aggrandizement, even with its liberal coating. On the 2nd of April, the members of the Prussian Parliament appealed to Frederick William IV to accept the imperial crown. Even Bismarck put his name to the letter. But Frederick William stuck to his monarchist principles. He would accept the crown, he replied, only if it were offered to him by the German princes. Bismarck hastily trimmed his sails. He, too, denounced the Frankfurt Assembly. Though he admitted that everyone who spoke German, including himself, wanted the unification of Germany, yet with this constitution I do not want it. He did not need to worry. Frederick William's refusal of the imperial crown ended the Frankfurt National Assembly. The moderate liberals, who were in the majority, went home in despair. The radical rump tried to put the imperial constitution into effect without either an army or an emperor. The Austrian forces were still fully engaged against the revolutions in Hungary and Italy. All the German princes clustered under Prussia for protection. The radicals had once planned to capture the Prussian army. Now this army turned them out of Frankfurt and suppressed the risings in Saxony and Baden. There was, in a sense, a Prussian conquest of Germany, but it was a conquest achieved against those who believed in German unification. Frederick William and his intimate adviser Radovitz tried to turn the situation to some account. The German princes were dependent on Prussian protection, therefore they could be induced to consent to Prussia's leadership of Germany. Yet, with the defeat of the radicals, this could be presented as a respectable, even a conservative, programme. The princes had no choice so long as Austria was without weight in Germany, and Radovitz badgered them into setting up the Erfurt Union, a lesser Germany with a parliament, elected on a limited suffrage, and its armed forces under Prussian control. This was almost exactly the Germany which Bismarck created 20 years later, but at the time he could not denounce it enough. "We are Prussians, and want to remain Prussian." Instead of challenging Austria, they should return to the system of Metternich, the agreement of Austria and Prussia to control the whole of Germany. Another saying of his in the Prussian Parliament was to read oddly later. Opposing civil marriage, he declared, "I hope to see the ship of fools of the age wrecked on the rock of the Christian Church." He was always ready to challenge the liberal politicians with some provocative phrase. Yet in 1849 he took a step on the road to professional politics and away from a quiet Junker life. He farmed out the lands at Schönhausen, which had come to him on the death of his father in 1845, and rented a house in Berlin. The Parliament of the Erfurt Union actually met in April 1850. The liberals from the Frankfurt Assembly were in the majority, and Bismarck protested against everything as usual. But the struggle for mastery in Germany had still to be fought. The Austrian Empire had recovered its strength. Italy and Hungary were subdued, and despotic Austria enjoyed the favour of the Tsar. Schwarzenberg was determined to reassert Austria's preeminence in Germany. He revived the Diet of the old Confederation, which had fallen into oblivion at the beginning of the Revolution, and looked round for a conflict. He soon found one. The Elector of Hesse, once a member of the Erfurt Union, was at odds with his subjects. He appealed to the Confederation to restore order, and the Diet authorized Austrian and Bavarian troops to intervene. This was a vital challenge to Prussia. For apart from the question of the Union, the Prussian military road, which joined the Rhineland to Brandenburg, ran through Hesse. Frederick William was at first all for resistance. Radovitz was made foreign minister, and preparations were made to mobilize the Prussian army. Shots were exchanged between Austrian and Prussian soldiers for the first time since 1778. The king's conservative advisers soon revolted. They shrank from a war in which they would have to call on revolutionary France and even on Sardinia against the two legitimist powers, Austria and Russia. The Minister of War discovered that the army was not prepared for war, and Bismarck, as a lieutenant of the reserve, felt it his duty not to raise his voice against a general. Radovitz resigned, and his successor, Manteuffel, met Schwarzenberg at Olmütz. He agreed to disband the Erfurt Union and to join in restoring the old Confederation. The course of Prussian aggrandizement was temporarily arrested. Even the most conservative felt the shame of Olomouc. When Manteuffel came to defend it in Parliament, he said ruefully, "The efforts of Prussia have not been crowned with success. There is always something sad in the failure of a policy." Bismarck had no such regrets. He alone defended the settlement of Olomouc without reserve. He repudiated the notion that Prussia should play the Don Quixote for offended parliamentary celebrities. The Erfurt Union would not have united Germany. "It would have made us shoot and kill our German fellow countrymen in the south." And he praised Austria as a German power which had the good fortune to rule over foreign races. Bismarck regarded Olomouc as a decisive defeat for the Revolution of 1848. Liberal dreams of German unity had been shattered, and the conservative system of Metternich had been restored. Historic right had triumphed over national freedom. Yet at heart, Bismarck had no sympathy with this outlook. When one of his conservative friends said that Austria had right on her side, he answered, "I don't recognise any right in foreign policy." And he said in his parliamentary speech, "The only healthy foundation for a great state is egoism, not romanticism, and it is unworthy of a great state to dispute over something which does not concern its own interest." There was no doubt a case to be made against Radovitz and the policy of the Erfurt Union. Prussia lacked allies. The Tsar would perhaps have supported Austria. The German liberals were strong only in words. The Prussian army was inadequate. Yet, reviewing Bismarck's arguments, it is difficult to resist the impression that the policy of uniting the lesser Germany without Austria had one overriding fault in his eyes. It was being conducted by Radovitz instead of by Bismarck. He declared, in words worthy of John Bright, "Woe to the statesman who at this time does not seek a cause for war which will still be valid after the war. Will you have the courage then to go to the peasant in the ashes of his cottage, to the cripple, to the childless father, and to say, 'You have suffered much, but rejoice with us, the constitution of the Union is saved'?" Powerful rhetoric. But could not a critic have said the same of the wars which Bismarck conducted in 1866 and 1870? Yet Bismarck was not insincere. Like many great men before they find their vocation, he specialised in denunciation and harsh invective. The elder Pitt confessed late in life the injustice of the attacks on Walpole by which he made his name. Mussolini, who opposed the Italian conquest of Libya in 1911, himself conquered Abyssinia in 1935. Lloyd George, the pro-Boer of one war, was the man who won the war of the next. And Stalin rejoiced in 1945 at having revenged the Tsar's defeat in what he had once called the criminal Russo-Japanese War. Men see things very differently when they are themselves in power. It did not yet occur to Bismarck that he would ever attain power. After Olomouc, he remained the provocative and irresponsible critic. His last words in Parliament as a private member were thoroughly in character. "Be sure, gentlemen, that we shall know how to make the name of Junkerdom honoured and respected." When Parliament adjourned, he puzzled for some means of adding to his income in order to support his growing family, a son and a daughter with another son born in 1852. He even thought of returning to the state service which he had given up so emphatically 12 years before. Opportunity came unexpectedly. With the restoration of the German Confederation, Prussia needed a delegate to the Federal Diet at Frankfurt. It would be a thankless task to acknowledge in daily practice the Austrian supremacy which had been recognised at Olomouc. Who so suitable as Bismarck, the one Prussian who apparently had a genuine belief in cooperation with Austria? He had had only 6 months' experience of administration and none of diplomacy. In all the history of the Prussian monarchy, he was the only man ever appointed to a high diplomatic post without previous service. However, his training might be enough to handle the economic questions, which were the only important German issues for the men in Berlin. If he failed, no one would be the worse for it. Bismarck was not alarmed. "I shall do my duty. It is God's affair to give me understanding." For once, he could say with truth, "I have not sought it, the Lord wished it," though the Lord's name was invoked primarily for its effect on his wife. She would have liked him to give up all public affairs and settle down in the country. He, without knowing it, had turned his back on a quiet life for good and all. He was to serve Prussia, Germany, and God without interruption for more than 39 years. In other words, his feet were at last on the ladder of power. He was 36. 2. The Diplomat. With the meeting of the Federal Diet at Frankfurt, the old order in Germany seemed to have been restored unchanged. This was far from being the case. Though the Great Revolution had blown over, the men who ruled in Vienna and Berlin had been shaped by their experiences in it. Frederick William IV went on dreaming of some impossible stroke by which he could make Prussia dominant in Germany with Austrian consent. Though he would never go against Austria, he would also never accept subordination to her. Manteuffel, the foreign minister, knew nothing of foreign affairs. He was an old-style civil servant who had been pushed into the office on the sudden death of Brandenburg in November 1850, and he had no plan of foreign policy. All he wanted was to keep out of difficulties, but he too had a sturdy Prussian pride and would not accept Austrian orders. There was a greater change on the Austrian side. Her rulers had acquired new confidence from their victories in Hungary and Italy. They despised Metternich's gentle methods and thought that rudeness was the best diplomatic method. Schwarzenberg, who directed Austrian policy until his sudden death in 1852, planned to include the entire Habsburg monarchy in the German Confederation, and a conference to achieve this was held at Dresden early in 1851. But the smaller states, who had welcomed Austrian support against Prussian encroachment, were equally opposed to Austrian control and voted solidly against her plans. The Confederation had to be carried on unchanged. The Federal Diet had 17 members, the larger states one each, the smaller lumped together with 5 delegates. Previously, Metternich had run the Diet in partnership with Prussia and arranged the business, such as it was, with her delegate beforehand. Now the Austrians asserted their presidential position and planned to control Prussia with the votes of the smaller states. In any international organization, it is easy to forget in peacetime the realities of power. And since Prussia had only one vote, the Austrians assumed that she was on the same level as Bavaria or even Schaumburg-Lippe. Bismarck, perhaps, went to Frankfurt with the sincere intention of cooperating with Austria. For him, at any rate, the perils and humiliations of the revolutionary year were not forgotten. More probably, he had not thought about his future policy. He always lived in the moment and responded to its challenge. In the Prussian Parliament, the Liberals had been his enemy, and he answered them by preaching cooperation with Austria. Now, at Frankfurt, his opponent was the Austrian delegate, and he reacted at once without thought for consistency. He did not weigh Prussia's strength or her position in Europe. He saw only his immediate opponent and wanted Prussian policy to be subordinated to his own needs. He was always quick to take offence personally, and Austria's heirs as the presiding power were enough to offend a less sensitive man. The Austrian delegate arranged business and often settled matters without consulting his colleagues. Bismarck insisted, like the Russians at the United Nations, on knowing every detail. A trivial gesture announced the coming struggle for mastery in Germany. Only the Austrian delegates smoked at meetings. Bismarck pulled out a cigar and asked the Austrian for a match. His act showed that he was a man of a new sort. Previous Prussian delegates had been high aristocrats, and like all the men of the old order, non-smokers. Only Austrian aristocrats smoked, a habit they acquired when they inherited the tobacco monopoly from Napoleon in Lombardy. Bismarck had learnt to smoke from the radical students whom he otherwise despised, and his cigar was a reminder that he really belonged to the world of the Burschenschaft, despite his affectation of sympathy with the principles of Metternich. The conflict was repeated in every conversation. Thun, the Austrian, sneered at the legacy of Frederick the Great, and compared Prussia to a man who, having once won a prize in a lottery, based his annual budget on it. Bismarck replied, "If that is what they think in Vienna, Prussia will have to speculate in the said lottery again." The Austrians did not take Bismarck's complaints seriously, nor admit that their policy had changed. They perhaps behaved with more arrogance than in the days of Metternich, but they had always behaved with much. Even Metternich did not really regard Prussia as Austria's equal. He flattered her because flattery was his way, but he thought of Austria as the only great power in Germany. Bismarck unconsciously confessed that the change originated in himself, not in the Austrians. He wrote in February 1852, "Since the month of September of last year, Austria has abandoned the ground on which we used to meet." But nothing had happened in September 1851 so far as Austria was concerned. The only significance of the date was that Bismarck then received official confirmation of his appointment as Prussian representative. Once more, he changed his policy simply because of his personal feelings. He had advocated cooperation with Austria when he was attacking Radovitz. He swung over to Radovitz's programme of a lesser Germany when he felt that the Austrian representative was not treating him as a social equal, and this personal resentment was at once translated into high-flown political terms. "I conceived the idea of withdrawing Germany from Austrian control At least that part of Germany united by its spirit, its religion, its character, and its interests to the destinies of Prussia, northern Germany. He made no pretense as yet that this was what the Germans wanted. He admitted frankly that the best thing for the Confederation would undoubtedly be to put ourselves and all German governments under Austria, militarily, politically, and economically. But advantage for the Confederation cannot be the guiding line of Prussian policy. His aim, in fact, was to divide Germany with Austria, not to unite it. The conflict on which he set out could not be settled by votes at the Frankfurt Diet. The smaller states, with no real strength of their own, went with Prussia against any Austrian attempt to unify Germany. They swung round just as much to the Austrian side if Prussia made any positive proposals. Bismarck wrote to Berlin, "Only outside Germany can we find the means to strengthen our position in the interest of Germany itself." He had no faith in public opinion or in liberal support. Foreign alliances, not an appeal to German feeling, would solve the German question. Hence Bismarck concentrated on European diplomacy, not on the intricacies of federal politics. His guiding principle was the aggrandizement of Prussia, according to the principles of Frederick the Great.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.